Hello friends, welcome to medicine classes for dummies. Today we will be discussing about the ventilation perfusion of our lungs. So first we will discuss the perfusion part. So in the perfusion, the lung is divided into four zones. That is zone 1, 2, 3 and 4. 1, 2, 3 and 4. So even though there are four zones, in normal individuals only zone 2 and 3 exist in the lung. And zone 1 and 4 appear in the lungs in only in pathological conditions. So before understanding these four zones, we should be aware of some pressures which determine the flow of inflow and outflow of air inside the lungs. So let's familiarize with a few terminologies. PA. PA is alveolar pressure. PPA is pulmonary arterial pressure. PPV is pulmonary venous pressure. PISF is pulmonary interstitial fluid pressure. And PPL is transpulmonary pressure. These terms we should be aware of. So in further discussion, we will only be saying PA, PPA, PV, PISF and PPL. So we have already discussed that in normal lungs, only zone 2 and 3 are there. And zone 1 and 4 appear in pathological conditions. So in zone 1, the PA will be more than PPA, because as we go above the level of the heart, the PPA will reduce, and at a point the P alveolar pressure will increase more than the pulmonary arterial pressure, and so the alveoli will be open, and this opened alveoli, because of the high pressure, they will compress the artery. So this is like the alveoli will be like this, and the vessels will be going through the alveoli like this. So, if the pulmonary artery alveolar pressure is higher than pulmonary arterial pressure, means this will compress on this. So, this alveoli will compress upon the vessel, and so the vessel will be collapsed. So, in the zone 1. So, what happens is there is only air, that is alveoli will only be open and the vessel will be completely collapsed. And so, there will be no perfusion occurring in that region. So zone 1 will be like a dead space area. There is like wasted ventilation. No air exchange is occurring. So zone 1 appears in like a oligemic shock, where the all the arterial pressure will be low because of the hemorrhage which is happening inside the body. And so the pulmonary arterial pressure will also be low, and it will come down below the alveolar pressure. And in that case, zone 1 appears in the lung. Also, zone 1 appears in conditions like where we give positive pressure ventilation, in which we give a large tidal volume. Tidal volume is very high, or the PEEP is very high, positive end expiratory pressure is very high. In such condition, the pulmonary alveolar pressure will increase, and that will increase very high, and that will come above the pulmonary alveolar arterial pressure, and that will result in the appearance of zone 1. Even in normal individuals, why there is no zone 1? Because always the pulmonary arterial pressure, PPA, will be higher than PA in a normal condition. So if we do like a large tidal volume, or we increase the PEEP very much, this alveolar pressure will increase more than the pulmonary arterial pressure. Or if there is an oligemic shock in which this pressure comes down very much, so in that case also this zone 1 appears. So zone 2 is like a waterfall area. So in west zone 2, it is the pulmonary arterial pressure which is greater than the pulmonary alveolar pressure, which will be greater than the pulmonary venous pressure. Normally in all vascular beds, it is the arterial venous pressure difference which determines the blood flow. But in zone 2 of the heart, it is the arterial alveolar pressure difference which determines the blood flow. So as we come down from upper to lower part of the lung in zone 2, the pulmonary arterial pressure gradually increases, and as a result the blood flow gradually increases in zone 2 from up to down. So this is known as the waterfall phenomena, which was already discussed in one of our previous videos, which details about the west zones. So in third zone, that is the west zone 3, it is the pulmonary arterial pressure which is greater than which will be the highest, but it is pulmonary venous pressure which will be greater than the pulmonary alveolar pressure. So here actually the arterial venous pressure difference is the one which determines the blood flow. So in this region the blood flow is almost constant. And zone 4, there is a new pressure which appearing in zone 4, that is the pulmonary interstitial pressure. So as the as we come down the lung zones, that is from zone 2 to 3 to 4. So in zone 1 we have seen that the vessels are fully compressed. But as we come down, the vessel's caliber starts increasing and it starts bulging. And what happens in zone, so this is the vessels will be appearing in zone 3, while in zone 4 the pulmonary artery pressure will be very high, so that the high hydrostatic pressure inside the vasculature will drive a fluid from inside to outside of the vessels, and that will create exudation of fluid from the vascular space to the extravascular space, and that will result in creation of an interstitial pressure. And this interstitial pressure difference, and so in zone 4 it is a pulmonary arterial and the pulmonary interstitial pressure difference which determines the blood flow in the zone 4. So zone 4 normally do not appear. So in conditions like if there is a negative pressure pulmonary edema which appear in conditions like a laryngospasm, or if there is a tumor in the upper airway, in such conditions there will be a significant amount of interstitial pressure which is appearing because of the intense negative pressure which develop inside the lung, and that will result in the appearance of zone 4. So zone 2 and 3 only in normal lungs, and 1 and 4 in pathological conditions. So this is how. So in zone 4 actually, because of the high interstitial pressure, if it increases too much, the blood flow will gradually reduce in zone 4. So it is like gradually increasing from up to down in zone 2, almost constant in zone 3, and gradually decreasing in zone 4. This is how the perfusion of the lung is distributed. So I hope everybody is clear about how the blood flow is distributed in the lung. Now we will discuss about the ventilation. How is ventilation distributed from upper to lower part of? So now we will discuss how the ventilation is distributed in the lungs. So before that, we should be clear about two pressures in understanding ventilation. So one is the pulmonary alveolar pressure, which was same as that which was discussed during perfusion, and another one is the transpulmonary pleural pressure. So these two pressure difference, that is the pulmonary alveolar minus transpulmonary pleural pressure, determines the ventilation in our lungs. So how we can understand? So alveolar pressure will be is equal to the atmospheric pressure, because it is atmospheric air which is entering inside the alveoli. So what is this pleural pressure? To understand the pleural pressure, I will say an example. Like we imagine our lungs. So we imagine our lungs as a bag of loose viscoelastic material. So what happens if we hang a bag of loose viscoelastic material? That bag will assume a globular shape because of the effect of the gravity. So our lungs, it will behave like it is like a viscoelastic material. And so if we hang our lungs, it should attain a shape like this. But our lungs cannot attain this shape because there is a chest wall surrounding it. So there is always a pull of the chest wall surrounding our lung. So it cannot attain this globular shape. But it can almost attain a globular shape like this because there is still an effect of gravity which is there. So this chest wall will pull the material back, pull the lung backwards and prevent the lung from attaining a globular shape. But still there is some effect of gravity which pulls the material in this viscoelastic bag downwards. And as a result, there is a small globular shape developing for the lung. So this is how the lung will behave. The lung shape will appear in the presence of the chest wall. So in this we can say that at the upper part of the lung, there will be so much because of the effect of gravity, there will be a lot of pull of the lung towards downwards. But here almost it will be like the lungs will be pushed towards sideways. So it is what happens to our lungs inside the chest cavity. So without the chest supporting chest wall, the lung will attain a globular shape. But with the supporting chest wall, it cannot assume the globular shape because the chest wall pulls the lung backwards. But still there is the effect of gravity. So it will attain almost a shape like this. So in this, the upper part of the lungs will be more pushed downwards. So there will be a more negative pressure developing in the
upper part of this is actually in between the lung and chest wall is the pleural space. So because of this fullness there in the upper part, there will be a more negative pressure developing in the upper pleural space. While towards the lower part of the lung, that is lower part of the lung and chest wall, there is the pressure of this lung pushing down towards sidewise towards the chest wall, and as a result the pressure inside the pleura at this region will be positive. Okay, so here the pleural pressure is more negative and here the pleural pressure is more positive. So what happens is that here the pressure difference will be, so the alveoli, how much the alveoli is open is determined by the pressure difference between the alveolar and the pleural pressure. So here the alveolar pressures are always atmospheric pressure, so it will be positive. So here what happens is that in the upper part of the lung there is a large pressure difference, that is here it is negative and inside the alveoli it is positive. So because of this large pressure difference, the alveoli in the upper part of the lung will be wide open. So the alveoli will be very much open in the upper part because there is a huge pressure difference in the upper part. But as it comes down, the pressure difference reduces and as a result, the alveoli will be less open as we come down the lung. So the maximum opened alveoli will be in the apex of the lung, but the alveoli will be less open in the lower part of the lung. Okay, so this is how the alveoli will behave inside the chest cavity in presence of the transpulmonary pleural pressure. Now we will say a word about how is the pleural pressure determined. So how much is this transpulmonary pressure difference between the apex and the base of the lung? So it will be like, so we know that the pressure difference will be height into density into gravity. So the density of the lung is 1/4 of the density of water. So it is 1/4 the density of water. So this pressure of water, so this will be like a height, about upright lung will measure about 30 centimeters. So 30/4 will be almost in centimeters of water will be the pressure difference, that is 7.5 centimeter pressure difference will be there from the apex, from the upper part to the lower part of the lung. So it will be the transpleural pulmonary pressure increases by 7.5 centimeter of water from top to the bottom of the lung. So this is how we calculate the transpulmonary pressure. So as we come down, the difference is less, so the alveoli are less open. But in the upper part, there is a very large difference between the alveolar and the transpulmonary pressure. So it will be wide open. So now we will see how it will affect, how it is going to affect the perfusion of the, how it is going to affect the ventilation of the lung segments. So like in the previous diagram we have discussed that the upper part will be like the maximum distended alveoli, and as we come down the alveoli will be less distended. So if we compare this into a pressure volume curve, so this is showing like every 5 centimeter difference in the transpulmonary pressure in this segment of the lung, that is it is like there is a wide variation in volume, that is for this small change in the transpulmonary pressure, the volume of the lung has increased from 2500 to 3000. That is 1500 volume change is there for a 5 centimeter pressure change. But in this part of this, in this part of the segment, for that 5 centimeter pressure change, there is only a even smaller volume change. And in this part of the segment, for this 5 centimeter change, there is only less than 500 ml of pressure change is there. So this is the pressure volume curve. So from this we can understand that this part of the curve represents this this part of the alveolar segments. So in this part of the alveolar segments, if there's a small change in pressure can cause a large increase in the volume of the that part of the lung segment. So this part of the lung can expand, the alveoli can increase in size to the maximum, because these are the maximum, this comes in the steep part of the pressure volume curve, while this part of, that is the middle part of the alveoli, there is an increase in volume but not much like that of the lower part, and the upper part of the alveoli are maximum distended. They cannot distend further. They have reached the almost their maximum size. And if there is a pressure change of almost 5 cm transperimetry pressure change, the volume increase in happening in that upper part is very smaller. So this is how the ventilation. So these are maximum distended. There is no further increase in this alveolar size in the upper part, while in the middle part there is considerably more increases there, while in the lower part there will be maximum increase in size of the alveoli occur in the lower part of the lung. So this is how the ventilation and perfusion of the lung segments are distributed. So hope you understood. We will discuss in our next video about the ventilation perfusion ratios and their clinical applications, and how we can set the ventilators according to that. Hope you all enjoyed the video. Hope everybody understood the concepts behind this ventilation and perfusion. So see you all in next video. Thanks for listening. Have a nice day.